Hello everyone and welcome to part 2 of this week's video for Laurence Plays Factorio Space Exploration with Krastorio 2. And the first thing we're going to talk about is why this core mining area over here is no longer jammed up. So in last week's video we had a massive jam due to an excess of uranium. So this belt all the way along here backed up all the way back up here, back up to here, and was jamming up all of the outputs here, and that was breaking absolutely everything. Now, spoilers, you'll have noticed if you watched yesterday's video, I don't know if it's spoilers, but I've reloaded the previous save, and so I've gone back a little bit in time. But we also have a problem with an excess of coal, so this warehouse here is getting... By the time I'd been recording the video for half an hour, this warehouse had filled up completely, so we do have a surplus of coal that we're going to need to worry about, but that hasn't actually become a problem yet. So yes, the uranium was a problem, because over here we have a uranium drop-off area where it goes through here, it's covrexed up nicely, and then we aren't dealing with the stone very well from here. So I think it was Tristan says he's fixed this, and there is now presumably a train that will come here. So there are various stone pickup. This is a priority one, so there are a train will come here to pick up the stone. At some point, this one might be on its way here now, or it might be going to a different stone priority pickup station. But it was causing some problems because the trains just simply weren't getting up here. No, this one's going to the core mining priority pickup. So we have too many high priority stations at the moment, and they're all high priority, because if we have too much stone there, then that one will jam. If we have too much stone here, then as you can see, then the uranium processing jams. And whilst we seem to have quite a lot of uranium 238 over here, so we've got two warehouses full and then another one that's mostly full. I don't know why we're not enriching more of this, to be honest. We are currently at, I suppose probably because this is also mostly full, but even so, I feel that we should probably try and pump a bit more through the other covrexing. I don't know, how is this working? Oh, it is coming, but it is being brought back out. This is a weird tangle of everything. So what have we got here? Look, it looks like there were some extra warehouses down here to store more overflow, and then that's been passed back up to here. And then from here, it's being passed out into the covrex system up there, and also into the stations. And from here, we are prioritizing the stuff that's being dropped in by delivery cannon, fine. And then we're bringing some in from the processing that's here. That's fine. That's then going to that. So that is then going off to prioritizing taking it off to be covrexed. And then any overflow from that is then not going anywhere, because this is all a little bit weird. I'm sure there were good intentions here at some point, but at the moment it's all a bit of a mess and a tangle of belts and I suspect what's happened here is that somebody's come in, fiddled with this repeatedly in an attempt to make it work better, and has also then just caused it to be a bit strange. And I think, judging by all the warehouses around here with Tristan's name on them, I'm probably going to blame him. Although it is kind of hard to tell. Similarly, in an attempt to deal with some of the general excess of resources we have now, which is as I say, a weird problem to have, over here, we had the problem that you saw last week, and this is where we're getting explosions, where we have far too much glass being brought in from the exoplanets that are turning all the stone that comes from their core processing is being turned into glass and then shipped over to Norvis, because we thought at the time we had a basically insatiable appetite for glass, so therefore shipping it all over here would be great. So it's then being passed over into this storehouse through all of these warehouses, and you can see these half full. But mostly empty. So we do have another warehouse and a half and a strong box available for storing excess glass overflow, but we haven't made any changes to the way the glass is being produced or the way it's being used up. So this is very much going to just be a temporary thing. And we could put in another couple of warehouses over here, but we are still just going to have too much glass. And given that we've seen we also have too much stone because we're not able to use it up fast enough from the priority supplies, there is a bit of a problem here. I'm not sure what we're going to do about this. But the funny thing is, I remember in 0.5 having massive problems with not enough glass, because I was needing to make it at such a rate, particularly for making the vitalic acid containers, that I was getting through crazy, crazy quantities of it. But here, we seem to have the exact opposite problem. So that's going to be a tricky one to fix. I'm not sure how we're going to deal with this. It might just have to be a case of use more stuff, and then we can churn through the glass, turning it into science and all the other stuff that's used for. But at the moment, we just have far too much of it. There are a lot of things that use glass. There's a whole 58 of them, as you can see here. But making more chemical plants is not going to get through the stockpile. More tech cards, maybe, because I mean we're using three for every blue tech card we make. So as we do science, we are churning through some glass at least. Electronic components, these are going to be something that gets through quite a lot of it. It's only two for every four that we make, which isn't amazing. And that is assuming we're still using this recipe. Is there more than one recipe for electronic components? Yes, we've moved over to the lithium recipe because it's more efficient. And so we're using up a lot less glass because of that. Now that does also reduce our plastic consumption, so it's sort of worthwhile. But maybe we should actually be saying we'll use up a bit of extra plastic in order to just sink more stone through the process in the forms of glass and silicon. But I don't like that. I don't really like that very much. It feels wasteful. Biolab, sure, but then we don't make many of those. Don't make many electrolysis plants. Greenhouse. We could make an enormous number of laser turrets. I mean, that would use up a certain amount of glass, sure. Okay, so we use a bit of it for corrosion resistance data, which is vaguely useful. Oh, we use a lot for the data storage substrates, unless there's another recipe for those that I don't remember. There is another recipe for those. It uses the rare metals. Again, it feels wrong to suggest that we should solve our oversupply problems by switching to less efficient recipes. And this one would use quite a lot more iron as well. So, I don't really want to. It feels like a step backwards. The new recipe for low-density structures will get through a decent amount. So that's one for every low-density structure, and we get through quite a lot of those. But to use this, we need to have a good supply of aeroframe scaffolds available as well. And having a good supply of aeroframe scaffolds means we need a lot of cryonite, we need a lot of immersion, we need a lot of beryllium. And in order to get those, we're then going to end up with more stone being produced because a lot of it's done from core mining, and that's going to get shipped in as more glass. So I don't know whether that would actually help or not. If I can get more of the the astro science working, we're using a little bit of glass for the observation frames, so sure, that's a little bit. But then again, I'm using the more efficient recipe here, where I'm using beryllium instead of steel, and therefore it's only a tenth of a glass that gets used for each of these. We are churning through a decent number of multispectral mirrors, but once again, we're using the more efficient recipe. But still, that is two glass to every mirror, so. We are making solar panels. That's somewhere where we're going to be using a decent amount of glass up. And the Vitalic reagent, that's probably going to be a good sink for it once we get to that level of biological sciences, because it's four glass for each one of these and a load of lithium chloride. So yeah, that's going to help a bit. And the nutrient vats as well. But as you can see as we flick through this, most of the stuff that uses glass is just straight up is building infrastructure like chemical plants, and you can't expand out and make enough chemical plants in order to use up a glass supply. So it's going to be tricky. I think we're going to have to sort of keep going and keep an eye on it and try and decide what to do, because I don't want to void it. You can't turn it into landfill. We could turn the stone into landfill, I suppose, but yeah, it sort of feels a bit horrible. Similarly, with resources going to awkward places, we had we had at one point a delivery cannon system that was, what was it doing? It was bringing in the iron from other planets, I think, and then it was dropping it off in one of these sort of iron places. Yeah, here we go. So we were dropping in iron plates here, and then trying to pass them through the system to be taken away by trains. The problem is, the trains are not really taking away iron plates anymore. We're not really using iron plates from the smeltery. We're now taking off iron ingots everywhere because it's more efficient in so many ways that I've talked about before. It's cheaper on logistics, basically, because the trains can carry more iron in one go. It's not cheaper on production, even though we're using the we can put more productivity modules in, I think, because we are just making the plates from ingots down here. So that's an irrelevance. But we're getting the iron. But we aren't passing the iron plates through here, so they're not getting taken away. So in order to fix that, on the main bus down here, we're now dropping in iron plates here from the delivery cannon and putting them into the main bus here. And this is after where they get brought down onto the main bus as ingots and then chopped up into plates. So this works quite well as long as the main bus keeps the iron flowing. And as you can see here, there is some flowing through it. It's not an enormous quantity, but it's enough to keep up with the amount that's being brought in from other planets. So far, I think Tristan has only done that for Njord and Snowdrop, but they were the ones that were having the problem specifically. We'll need to keep an eye on the other ones just to see, but in general, we can now start bringing iron plates in here instead of over to the smeltery, because this way they will actually get used up. Oh, and he had a problem with processed fuel for trains on Njord as well, and that's been he sorted that out. So as you can see, at the moment, we've got to a point where our our science up here in space is it's basically working up to the point we've got it to. We've got as long as we have the resources coming in, we can do energy 1-3, astro 1-3, material 1-3, bio 1-2. I think I don't think we've got bio 3. Yeah, bio 1 and 2, and all the sort of the earlier precursor sciences, some of which are being shipped up from Norvis by space train, some of which are being made over here by these machines. So as long as the resources keep coming in, we're actually absolutely fine. All the systems up here seem to be okay. Now, I'm not saying they're definitely okay. We might need to go in and sort of do a little bit of tweaking of some of the ratios, some of the numbers of machines, that sort of thing. But basically, things seem to be okay. The problem is coming down now to the sort of the infrastructure that's providing the resources to up here. So we don't have enough beryllium coming in, as you've seen. There's a shortage of it over here. Although that was admittedly due to wiring problems, but we're not making it as fast as we're trying to use it. We've got similar things with I think we're still short of cryonite. It's not coming in as quickly as we'd like for some things. So we need and as you saw, we've got problems with uranium and stone and iron and copper and coal, and everything is in the wrong sort of quantities at the moment. So we need to do a bit of sort of messing around with it to try and get things to work nicely and all work and all just play well together, and produce the resources we need at the rates we need them at. And having an excess of things is a weird problem to have in Factorio. Normally you tend to find you go, oh, okay, I need to go off and make another copper mine, or I need to start supplying better from a copper planet in space exploration, that sort of thing. But at the moment, yeah, we're just having massive problems with excess of glass in particular. Now, I wonder, if we have a look back on Norvis, can we start making modules as a solution to this? So we are shipping glass into the module production area, and that is all being turned into... Okay, it's being turned into Tier 1 productivity modules, and we're using electronic components, so there's a fair amount of glass going in here. To make the Tier 1 ones... Okay, that's 25 glass to make a productivity module, a Tier 1 productivity module, and 10 electronics components, which is some more glass, and some red and some green circuits. Then you presumably need, yeah, you then need more green circuits and whatever we're short of here. Okay, red circuits, which also uses glass and stone, in order to make the a tier 2 productivity modules. So if we can get the red circuits up and running again and then just start getting through lots and lots of productivity modules, maybe that'll help a bit. The tier 3 productivity modules then use blue circuits, which is again still more red circuits, and certainly, and I think is therefore going to use a certain amount of glass and then vulcanite, which is a separate thing. So yeah, maybe by just putting more modules into our machines, we can, because modules are so expensive, especially the tier 1s and this match 25 glass per module they get through there, maybe that is going to be our savior for getting through a decent amount of the glass we've got. What is this all goes into? Oh, this also goes into electronic component manufacture down here. That's interesting. Is this using and this one is even using the more expensive recipe, where it churns through more plastic, glass, and silicon in order to make the electronics components, versus this one where you use a bit less and get significantly more. Well, you know, so you use slightly more and get a lot more out the other side. So yeah. It's a bit of a waste of plastic, because but other than that, we don't care about, because we've got too much stone and glass, we don't care about the silicon or the glass here. So actually, yes, I think using up a lot of productivity modules ideally of the reasonably high tiers, just to make it as expensive as possible, is going to be quite a good way to churn through a decent amount of the glass here. So maybe that's going to be our answer, at least in the short term. I wonder, will it tell me if I look in here and look at a tier 3 productivity module, does it tell me how much glass goes into that? It does tell me that 475 stone go into making one tier 3 productivity module, along with, admittedly, 460 copper, but we've got a lot of copper, and a lot of acid and a lot of petroleum gas. So, that's a slight concern, but as long as we think our oil supply is going to be able to keep up with this, this would be quite an effective way to churn through a massive, massive quantity of stone and quite a lot of copper as well. So, yeah, let's put productivity module 3s in absolutely everything we can find. And we are already doing that to an extent, but let's just do it more so. And now that we can start shipping, we can start working on spaceships and space trains to ship the Vitamelange extract over to... probably to Norbit, we start making the machine learning data up there as well. This is going to be another way to get through even more of it. So maybe starting to put prod 4s in things is going to be a viable thing here. And we do also, and again, we'll have all of the bits and pieces we need for this. So potentially, yeah, just upgrading the productivity modules in everything that doesn't use glass as an input, perhaps, is going to be a good way to get through a lot of the excess glass we've got. I mean, that would be an interesting way to do it. As you can see here, that's getting through 2,100 stone for every productivity 4 that's made. So that's a lot. But maybe it's what we need to do. Right, I'm now, I promise, going to try and stop talking about the resource problems. So let's go back to Norbit for a moment, because one of the other things I did while I was up here was get these two science packs, in theory, running smoothly, nicely, generally, happily. There were a few problems up here, so we'd run out of these iron ingots because the train bringing resources up wasn't working properly. And so now we've fixed that. We've now run out of vulcanite, so I'm going to have to go and have a look at that and see why we've run out of vulcanite. Let's have a quick look. See if Agnair and the other one that seems to be running properly. Yeah, Agnair has plenty, but presumably none of these are shipping to the space bus, which is where that is required. So that's Talos, Big Red. Ooh, that is in Orvis Orbit, but that's pretty sure that's not the space bus. That's something to do with Iridium. So that's going to be material science, but I don't know exactly what's going on there. I'm not sure what that one's doing. I don't know why is that. Oh, there's presumably enough in there. Yeah, so we don't appear to be shipping to the space bus from here, which presumably means that all the supplies of vulcanite that are going to the space bus are coming from Tashikuta. But there's no problems here either. Why? I don't know. This is going to need to be researched a little bit more carefully rather than me just going in and having a look at things. But that's definitely something to look at in the next episode, because we shouldn't be running out of vulcanite, especially as all of our vulcanite supplies seem to be absolutely fine. However, maybe this is an opportunity to start bringing it from Agnea to Norbit by spaceship and space train in order to just get that flowing a bit quicker. I've been saying that I want to sort of try and stop doing new things and try and get all of the infrastructure that we already have up and working well. Is it acceptable to go off and say, well, in order to get this infrastructure working well, I'm going to go off to and set up completely new infrastructure by going out and setting up spaceships and space trains? I'm not quite sure, to be honest, but it does feel like it might be. It feels tempting, put it that way. In order to get these basic space sciences up and running again, I also needed to sort out a couple of things that were causing some problems. And at the top of the list was the thermofluid here. So in a previous stream, I actually removed the area around the machines in here that were making the thermofluid, because I decided that we had quite a lot of it in the tanks, and I'd make that a problem for future Laurence, because we had loads of it there, and making it on site here was a silly idea when we're making it en masse elsewhere. Future Laurence then realised that past Laurence hadn't come in and actually fixed that problem, so I've done it in a slightly dirty, hacksy way. I'm now bringing in warm thermofluid from this station over here, which is for the general science area. That's being brought in over here in a pipe, and then we've got a pump here that is only pumping through when there is less than 10,000 in the storage tank at the other end that you just saw. So that's keeping this at about this sort of level, which is fine, about 40% full. And as the thermofluid deteriorates, we'll top it up gradually from over there. But other than that, this is a sort of a closed loop system, in that we're the thermofluid that is being warmed up by these science machines here is then being passed over to these some radiators over here that are chilling it back down again. So it's going round and round in this area. We're not making use of the chillers and the radiators in the science park. We're just tapping off a little bit of thermofluid from there. We also had this system jam up because we had so many junk data cards being produced by these machines that these two supercomputers here couldn't keep up, which was a bit rubbish. So now I'm just dumping all of the junk data cards out onto the disposal belt down here that flows along here and then down here and goes into the recycling area. And so we'll be shipping in slightly more memory cards up here. These will gradually be flowing through as we're doing the science there, rather than recycling them on site, because those machines couldn't keep up, and everything down there is set up a bit more nicely for it to keep all of that running. Now that this is all finished, I can just come in here and rip out probably, yes, all of this and all of the connections into that down here, like these ones, and then quite a bit more tidying up as well. I won't do that all right now because you don't care, but it does mean there's a bit of tidying up that can be done here, and that's going to free up a bit more space around here. And is this even needed anymore? I'm not sure. We'll have to think about that and work it out. While we're up here, Tristan has also started making the space rail up here in orbit, and this is generally a bit of a mess. Okay, so he's putting... Right, he's crammed it all in up here because reasons. I don't know why he didn't just put a belt down this way to to take away the normal rail and make it into space rail. Oh, he's not made his buses quite wide enough, that's the problem. So this one is 5 wide, this one is not 4 wide, and then he hasn't left room before these pipes start happening. So basically this is the problem he usually grumbles at me for creating, where there isn't enough, I haven't left enough room for future expansion on my buses. But in this case, he's been the one guilty of it, and so he's had to cram in the space rail production up here, because you need various energy science related things. So what is going on here? So he's making, we're bringing in the rail to here, which is then being, I see. So he's got, yeah, so around here he's making the holmium cables here from the holmium ingots and holmium plates that are coming through from this machine and the plastic that's coming through from this warehouse. So he's storing the plastic in here but not putting it out onto the bus because this is the only thing that needs it. He can then, when he has enough of them, he can then feed holmium cables down here, but also onto this, right, also they can be grabbed by this thing and put into here, so he's got some in this warehouse as well. Those can then be put into this warehouse, manufacturing machine here, along with the relevant data energy catalog that's coming up, presumably coming up this belt here. Yes. Okay. So he can, when he wants some, he can turn it on by doing that, and that'll pass the that'll then end up with some of the energy catalogs coming up here. Those will be fed into here, made into space rail, that can then be taken away by from the red chest here by bot, in order to be then loaded into wherever they're needed. We also have an iron supply system that is supposed to be taking iron ingots in from, I guess, here? Although I don't know quite how. Yeah, it's supposed to be taking in steel ingots from here and putting the plates back into here, so then this machine can take the plates and make them, but that isn't working. Maybe he's manually loading the steel plates. This is all just a little bit horrible, Tristan. I don't approve. I mean, okay, granted you said that you were crammed it in up here, but it just doesn't work. however, in theory, we will at some point then have space rail available here, which means it can then be claimed by the robots to build stuff up here, and also claimed to be taken over and dropped into the downstream stations over here, which is what this blue chest is for in theory, although that isn't finished. And then that can be dropped into here, taken down in the downstream trains, and then sorted out down on Norvis to use anything that's made up here in space, like higher tier productivity modules, for example, or space rail. Those can all be taken down in the downstream trains, dumped into the logistics system down there, and then used as appropriate down on Norvis in order to expand things out. So it's a bit of a work in progress at the moment. As you can clearly see, it just straight up doesn't work. But in the long run, I can sort of see what he's trying to get at here. Let's head back down to Norvis again, because a couple of things have happened here as well. I mentioned last time that I'd put in this area down here that's making the aeroframe scaffold, but I hadn't dealt with the pollution that it's generating, and that was starting to drift out beyond beyond our base down here. That seems to have been cleaned up a little bit, presumably by biters inhaling it and growing and producing new biters. So I also stuck in this system down here where I've extended a Marc belt that's supposed to be taking all of the filters from up here, and this doesn't seem to have quite worked. So somewhere down here, there was an area that has straight up not been built. Is that outside the Roboport? That is outside the Roboport network. So I'm going to need to fix that by adding in another Roboport here to extend this a little bit. And then we can, in theory, build up all of this. The problem is that we don't have in any of these air purifiers, and that's another victim of the red circuit shortage, I believe. We can see those trying to be made here, but if we look in the machine, yes, it's run out of red circuits. So once we get those red circuits up and running, we'll at least get the air purifiers being placed. The problem is still going to be that belt that hasn't got built up here. But once I drop in the extra Roboport here and get the coverage up, then that should be absolutely fine. It's slightly surprising, actually, that we have Roboport coverage over here, but not... And where's that coming? Oh, there's a Roboport out here, that's why. So I just need to stick another one in the gap here, or possibly just put it here. Anywhere around here, it will be absolutely fine. It didn't work because there's some water here. So the grid pattern they're being laid on got broken, because there should be one here, and there should be one here, but both of those, because they're in the water, they obviously didn't get placed. So, not too difficult to fix. Tristan has talked about putting in a dedicated red circuit drain for the for making the memory cards. I would say wait and see, because it may be that once we actually have red circuits, the train over here that brings up the red circuits and the circuit substrates might actually be sufficient, but we'll have to wait to find out until, you know, things are actually working properly to find out whether that's okay. Finally, is another thing, another minor crisis we had. We had a biter incursion, which was interesting. So this area up here only had one of these little sort of pillboxy output setup things with the eight lasers and a substation. So the biters managed to come down here. They chewed their way through the wall and then ate all the lasers and started to carry on sort of wandering inwards. They got down to about here. I'm not sure quite how we got rid of them. It's possible I don't think we lobbed a nuclear artillery at them, partly because they were full of green biters and that probably wouldn't have killed them all, and also because I was a little bit reluctant to blow up chunks of infrastructure up here, although, to be honest, taking out a roboport and two pylons, not the end of the world. We could have dealt with that. Or it could be that I think we put in some more lasers somewhere around here, maybe they all wandered over to them. So since then, Mike went in and put in some additional lasers along here, which is great, except that the biters can still just wander around the outside here and then come over and gnaw on the lasers, so it's not particularly well defended. Ideally, we want... we probably want to have a landfill going like this, maybe even down to about here, and then run a wall all the way down the edge of that, because this pale brown stuff here is shallow water, and that means you can't... You can't build on it. So I could build here, but I can't build on the shallow water. But you can walk on it, and that means the biters can come down, and so can the biters. So that means the biters could actually get through on this side, despite the fact that we can't build a wall across there. They could just walk around it, inch through the shallow water. We do seem to have got rid of them, though. They have gone away again. So maybe they wandered back up to the lasers. I'm not quite sure how we got rid of them, but we did. So that's the most important thing. So, finally, let's have a look at the research. We have researched spaceship clamps, and these are fantastically useful. They're basically 100% vital if you want to automate spaceships. You can buzz around in a spaceship all you like if you're flying it manually and landing it manually and all that sort of thing. But if you want to automate it properly, then you need spaceship clamps, because those are the things the spaceships use to decide where they're going to land and exactly... And then to also, you can use them to pass signals through as well. We have researched ion engines, and this is fantastic because ion engines are so much easier to fuel than rocket engines, because ion stream is mostly made out of energy and I think a little bit of stone and a few other sort of cheap ingredients like that. And that makes it really, really easy to produce and therefore to refuel your spaceships, and it just makes moving spaceships around very, very cheap. The downside is that you can't land on planets with ion engines, so our spaceships are basically going to be stuck moving from orbit to orbit. But with the space elevators, that's no longer a problem. Back in 0.5, I ended up fitting all my spaceships with ion engines to move quickly and cheaply through space, and then rocket booster tanks in order to take off from planets. And so they still required rocket fuel, which was a bit of a pain, but at least back then I had infinite oil. In 0.6, we've got the space elevators to lift them back up again, but to offset that, we no longer have infinite oil, so we need to be a little bit more careful with how much rocket fuel we get through. Speaking of ion stream simply costs rare metals and plasma stream, which is lithium, and chemical gel, which is petroleum gas, and water and lube, so which is heavy oil. So there is a certain amount of oil going into that. It's not a huge amount, but there is a bit. There's also a bit of lithium and some rare metals, but you can get quite a long way on your 100 ion stream, so it's still quite a cheap way of moving spaceships around. We've done a load of spaceship integrity researches, 1, 2, 3, 4, and 5. I talked about these last week. This basically means when we make our first spaceship, we'll be able to actually make quite a big spaceship, because we won't be restricted to the basic level of integrity you get, which is, I think, probably about 100. Then you move on to integrity 1, which gets you another 100. Yes, gets you another 100, and so on down the chain, so it's 100 each time. So that's going to allow us probably to make spaceships of size 600, which is big enough to actually be really quite useful, and mean we don't have to scrimp and save and scavenge every single square we can out of them, and we can be a little bit less efficient, and therefore it makes the design a bit easier, and it makes the spaceships a lot more useful because they can carry more stuff. Finally, we are working on worker robot at speed 8, which means they go a bit faster. I think that means they also can go a bit further, because I think the batteries in the robots are time-based rather than distance-based. So hopefully this will mean a little bit less robot recharging. I'm not certain about that, though, so let me know in the comments if I'm wrong. And that brings us to the end of the episode. I think this might have been slightly shorter than normal, but we were down to three players last week. Two and three quarter players last week, because Mike left early and Marc was off doing a work thing. So we were a bit short of people, so a bit less stuff than normal got done. But still, I hope that's still been interesting anyway, and you'll come along and join us on Monday for the next stream, where I hopefully we'll have everybody. We shall see how that goes. Then Tuesday, maybe there will hopefully be Factorio videos. I'm running a little bit low on buffer at the moment, but we'll see. There should be one for the non-supporters anyway, because there's last week's supporter episode to come out. Then Wednesday will be the XCOM stream. Everything went horribly last week, so I've decided to throw everything in the bin and start over again, not playing on Iron Man, to make it a bit more manageable, should we say. So make sure you submit to Soldier, because there's going to be a whole new army being put together. So here's your chance to get a brand new shiny Soldier with all kinds of, well, who knows what sort of stats they'll end up with. And then Friday, Saturday will be the update videos as normal, as you're used to. So please make sure you're subscribed to the channel so you don't miss any of those updates. Like, comment, subscribe, all those things a YouTuber asks you to do. And I'll see you in the next one. Thanks for watching, and goodbye.